जी बृंदा फ्रॉम सेंट जोसेफ कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग चेन्नई। आई एम प्लीज हियर टू रिप्रेजेंट दी एंड वेलकम एवरीवन टू दिस वेबिनार सेशन ऑन कोविड-19 नो मैजिक बुलेट्स एट यूज एसएमएस वाइजली। दिस सीम्स टू क्रिएट एन अवेयरनेस अगेंस्ट कोविड-19, हाउ टू प्रोटेक्ट एंड हाउ टू ओवरकम कोरोना वायरस, कन्वीन्ड बाय डॉक्टर एस निशांत, जनरल फिजिशियन एंड इंटेंसिविस्ट, एसकेएस Hospital and post graduate institute, Salem. And I welcome you, sir, for this evening session.
Thank you, ma'am. Good evening, one and all. Can I start, ma'am?
Yeah, sir, you can start.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Nishant. So I'm going to throw some light on COVID-19, the current pandemic going on, and we are facing it. Most of the points will be known to everyone, and it is going to be more of a refresher session, and I'm going to speak on two topics. The presentation can be divided into two parts. The first is the science, few technical details about the coronavirus and the COVID-19, and the second part is about the common questions which we all would have in our mind regarding the coronavirus, and these are the questions which are asked by my family members and my close friends. So I'm going to answer those common questions which you may also have in your mind. So this is going to consist of two parts: the science, the technical details of the corona and COVID, and the second one is the common questions. The first part, I try to make it as simple as possible so that everyone can understand about this corona and COVID. And being this is a short session of 15 minutes in time, I'll try to make as simple and short as possible. Going to the science part. So this in the science microbiology, so we are going to answer these questions. First is, what is this novel coronavirus? Second is, how does it spread? Third, how long it survives on surfaces? And actually, what it does to us? And regarding the incubation period, symptoms, how long a person will be infected, and what is the treatment available? Actually, this is not the first time we are facing a coronavirus. Previously, we have faced the coronavirus, that is the viruses from the family coronavirus, namely the SARS in the year 2002 and MERS, Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, 2012. And now we are facing third time the novel coronavirus, 2019. The mortality rate of MERS is 34.4%, whereas the novel coronavirus, as of now, it is maximum of 3 to 4%. So still we are more feared, and everyone is worried about this novel coronavirus compared to the MERS. Why? This is because it spreads very easily. This MERS did not spread easily, and it contained in the Middle East countries. And this time, due to this reason, we are seeing more cases. Thereby, we are much more panicked and worried about. So this is not the first time we are facing such a coronavirus. So where did this name come from? What is this coronavirus? Actually, this corona means, literally, in the literature, it means crown. And when it was first discovered in 1968, under the electron microscope, they observed a similar pattern compared to this solar corona. This is the layer around the sun. This is the first electron microscopic feature of coronavirus, which resembled the corona layer around the sun. That's why it is named the coronavirus. And few words about the structure. It is very small, 120 to 160 nanometer, and it is an RNA virus. I'm not going through very much details of it. And the more important part of it, what we all should know, is the modes of transmission. It spreads through droplets, fomites, and aerosol. What are these droplets? When we speak, sneeze, or expire, that is when we normally breathe, we do let out large amount of particles. Those are called, the large ones are called droplets. These droplets tend to spread very not for a very long range. It settle very near, maximum of 2 meter, I guess. And the fomites, these are the particles which spread comparatively longer distance, and it can cause more amount of dispersion of virus to other persons. And sorry, that is about aerosol. And fomites are the things which actually settle in the objects or the surfaces where we commonly touch. For example, the door handles, the laptops, the mouse, the phones in our office. So it spreads through predominantly two things. One is through the droplets and aerosols. Droplets are short range spreading one, and aerosols are long range spreading particles. And the fomites are the one which spreads through the touch, that is through particle, through the surfaces of the commonly used objects daily. So how these droplets and aerosols are generated? As I said before, it can be either through cough or either sneezing or coughing or exhaling. When a person sneezes, these droplets with aerosols spreads to 6 meters. When coughs, it spreads until 3 to 4 meters. In event of exhaling, that is, you forcefully expel the air out, it spreads up to 1 to 2 meters. So this is how it comes out of an infected person and infect another person. So this is why everyone is worried about the social distancing, so that one person, when maintains a distance of at least 6 meters, that is 2 feet from the infected person, the chances of acquiring infection will be very less. So having this in mind, what happens when an infected person wears a mask? So this is an infected person, the side view. This is the infected person when we see face to face. So this person coughs. What happens? There are large droplets and aerosols put in and around him. And when he wears a mask, we can see a relatively less amount of aerosol cloud and large droplets are generated. When he wears an N95 respirator, by now, most of us would have heard about this normal mask and N95 respirator. The amount of aerosol cloud and large droplets are still less. When we wear a respirator, that is elastomeric respirator, the amount of aerosol and large droplets which are put into the environment are still going to be less. So compared to not wearing a mask, the normal fabric mask or surgical mask is a bit safer, and N95 mask is more safer, and this respirator is going to be more safer in preventing spread from infected person to other person. So this is the effect of an infected person wearing a mask. Let us see what happens when you wear a mask and go near an infected person. So this is the infected person, this is you, that is susceptible host. You don't wear a mask, and what happens? This person, while you speak to him, he sneezes or coughs. What happens? Large amount of droplets directly comes into your nose and mouth. So inhale large amount of droplets, thereby large viral load. So you do become infected. When you wear a mask, the amount of viral load, that is aerosols or particles, which enter into your body becomes a little bit less. When you wear an N95 mask, it is still more less. And you wear an elastomeric respirator, that is, which are usually used by healthcare workers inside the hospital and ICU, the amount of droplets coming into your body is going to be still less. But do remember that even if you wear masks, these droplets and aerosols, when you don't maintain social distancing, these aerosols and clouds are going to come and deposit on your face, mask, and all your bearings, that is dress, clothes, etc. So this is the point I wanted to say. You wear a mask and go outside, and don't be of the opinion that you are very much safe. Obviously, you have reduced the amount of viral load entering into the body, but be aware that your mask may be infective. So handle the mask with care. I'll be telling how to handle the mask with care in the next half of the presentation. So always be aware that mask is going to reduce the amount of viral load which you are going to receive into your body. It is not going to protect you from contaminating the other surfaces of the body or your clothes or the objects you are carrying. So always be aware and be vigilant in handling your mask. So actually, these pictures are taken from this paper, going to spread through objects. As I said, when a person coughs, if you don't maintain a social distancing, there are chances that your dress or your objects, your watches, your ornaments can carry the fomites, and through which it can spread. So this common question we all had in our mind, do the coronavirus spread through the common objects we carry? Example, newspaper, the tumblers, the bottles, the ornaments what we carry. So this is one data, though the exact number of days or hours given may not be reliable, still the metal, the glass, ceramics, the papers, including newspaper, magazines, wood, plastic, stainless steel, cardboard, aluminium, copper, these all do can act as a medium through which the coronavirus can reach us. So we all should be aware of this and protect ourselves. The one good thing is, so far, the food and water doesn't seem to spread the coronavirus. So next, going to the important one. So we have taken adequate precautions so that we don't contract this virus. So suppose it entered us, what it does to us? This is one important question we all have. So before going to it, the normal anatomy. Most of you would have recognized this. This is the lungs. And the part I want you to concentrate this is the small air sacs that is called the alveoli. Small air sacs called the alveoli. When it is magnified, the alveoli looks like this. This is the air sac through which our oxygen and carbon dioxide exchange takes place. And this is the air sac and this is the blood vessel. The blood vessel carries the impure air that is containing carbon dioxide, which is sent out through the body through the air sac, that is the alveoli, through which it reaches our nose and goes out of the body. And this is the oxygen, which comes in from the atmosphere through the air sac and reaches our blood vessel. So this one diagram I had put to explain actually what happens and what actually kills us. So with this diagram in our mind, going to the next one, what it does to us? Actually, it causes two. There exist two hypotheses. One is, usually any viral or bacterial infection, when it enters the body, here I have mentioned the SARS-CoV-2, that is the coronavirus, novel coronavirus. When it enters, it activates the WBCs, simply called as this alveolar macrophages, called as the WBCs, white blood cells, they all know, which is the police force of the body. When this WBCs, this police force of the body, recognizes that there is a foreign organism entering into the body, what it does is, it tries to fight against the foreign organism which have entered into the body. So in turn, due to the sequence of many reactions, what happens is the air sac, which should contain only air, will contain a large amount of fluid. Technically, these are called the exudates. If we get a wound here, we'll get a swelling. What we actually have inside the swelling is the inflammation. Adipattu veengum, ulla thanni irukum. Adhe maadhiri, this alveoli also do get a fluid full air sac. So what happens is, the effective oxygen carbon dioxide exchange is hindered. So what happens? We don't get oxygen. Also, there's a difficulty in sending out the carbon dioxide which we have. So this is one hypothesis, and this is the common hypothesis for all the viral and bacterial pneumonia, that is the lung infection we have. This is what we had seen in the previous corona infection, like SARS and MERS. And recently, which Italy, which got badly affected, and US, the postmortem findings and other clinical studies have shown the other hypothesis. Before going to that, so the side by side, I will be speaking about the treatment also. For this hypothesis, what is the treatment modality? What I told, there is a problem in oxygen diffusion. So give oxygen, it may help in overcoming the oxygen deficit. Going to the second pathophysiology, that is what happens is, here the main possibility, what we are trying to hypothesis is hypercoagulability. Simply telling, ratham romba kattiya oranju poradu. So going back to the picture, here the blood is free flowing. If the blood clots here, ratham romba oranju pochina, the oxygen and carbon dioxide diffusion is again hindered. So oxygen carbon dioxide diffusion doesn't take place. So here what we can do, that is hypercoagulability. The treatment for hypercoagulability would be blood thinners, that is the heparin. So give some medications which will prevent the blood become thicker and clotted, so that the free flow of the blood is maintained, so that the oxygen carrying capacity of the lungs is not affected. So that's why the second modality of treatment, heparin, that is being used widely nowadays in COVID patients. And the next killer is going to be the cytokine storm. Simply telling, like I previously said, the police force of the body, WBCs, has some stimuli which increases some chemical substances in our body called the cytokines. Simply telling, the cytokines are the bullets of the police force which tries to go and act against the microorganisms. But when the cytokine storm overwhelms, it can even kill us. That is what happening in SARS-CoV-2. The cytokine storm overwhelms and goes beyond the body's mechanism to defend it, and our body itself succumbs to it, while the cytokine storm actually tries to fight against the organism. So to bring down the cytokine storm, there are few modalities, one of which being proven nowadays based on few studies is the steroids. So the two pathophysiology, one, the alveoli filled with fluid, what we commonly see with viral illnesses, this is one hypothesis. For this, the treatment is going to be oxygen. The second one, clotting of pulmonary blood vessels causing oxygen deprivation. Here, oxygen alone is not going to help. These, in addition, we are using blood thinners, and the killer is going to be the cytokine storm, for which we do use steroids. So we will not be able to actually diagnose what is the major problem going into this patient, whether the first hypothesis or the second hypothesis. So this is a big hurdle in management in the current pandemic, and this leads to a lot of mortality and morbidity in patients. So that is, in short, what happens when the SARS-CoV-2 enters into our lungs. As I said, the cytokine storm, the bullets of the police force of the body, it not only affects the lung, it affects almost all important organs in our body, say heart, causing heart failure, kidneys, renal failure, gastrointestinal system, causing the diarrhea, and all translocation of bacteria from the gut to the body, which cause secondary sepsis, and brain, which can cause neurological dysfunction. I'm not going to details of the other or effect of coronavirus on the other organs. So going to the next one, COVID timeline. This is taken from NEJM. So the incubation period, the median incubation period, say 5 days, which can range from 3 to 18 days. So once this is the 5 days median incubation period. So here the onset of symptoms. So median days to onset after development of initial symptoms, the dyspnea, that is breathlessness, here dyspnea, which is a technical term for breathlessness, by 6th or 7th day, patient may develop breathlessness. This do occur in 40% of patients, and only in 14% of patients severe illness, and only in 5% of patients going to land up in critical illness. Only 5% of the total population going to get land up in ICU. This is an important thing we should have in mind. Not all corona positive patients are going to land up in ICU and going to die. Only 5% of patients. If suppose 100 patients are corona positive, only 5 of them are going to land up in ICU. This is an important take-home message all to remember. And so we have acquired the infection, and it has entered the body. We are going to get symptoms. What are the symptoms? 3 cardinal symptoms described in coronavirus: the first, fever; second, shortness of breath; and the third, cough. Cough predominantly dry. If you get second infection, it can be wet. So fever, shortness of breath, cough. Going into details of it, there can be more of asymptomatic infection. That is, a patient coming to you for some other reason, say a small accident, a head injury. And as a part of hospital protocol, which many of the hospitals do follow now, you do a chest X-ray or CT scan, you do find some abnormalities in the CT scan. Still, patient may not have any dry cough, may not have any fever, may not have any shortness of breath. This is one end of the spectrum of COVID infection. The other end spectrum is patient can quickly deteriorate to acute respiratory distress syndrome. That is, patient will not be able to maintain his oxygenation, which causes respiratory failure. Due to inadequate oxygen in the body, every organ in the body, starting from brain, heart, liver, kidney, everything fails, and patient finally succumbs to the infection. This is the spectrum. This asymptomatic infection and mild infection constitutes about 95% of patients, and critical illness and the other moderate and severe do constitute only 5 to 10% of infections. So these are the phases. A patient, this is time course, this is severity of illness. This is the day one of symptom. The first 5 or 7 days, this is the viral response phase. That is, the virus takes its time to enter in the body to replicate and show the symptoms. So as I said before, mild constipation symptoms, fever, dry cough, and then the shortness of breath, and then the ARDS. This ARDS is predominantly due to the inflammatory response. As I said before, the cytokines, the bullets of the WBCs, which trying to fight against the organism, it also causes damage to us. When the host is weak and not able to tolerate it, succumbs. Here the host is us, the patient, succumbs and dies. So this is the early infection, this is the pulmonary phase, this is the hyperinflammation phase. So what we can do in the viral response phase, when the patient is not so much symptomatic, we can give the antivirals. There are two, three antivirals which are being prescribed now. The first one is Remdesivir. I'm not going into the scientific details of those drugs. The other one is Lavipravir, and few other drugs are on the way. So right now, the most common drug, two drugs being prescribed are the first one, Remdesivir, and the lesser prescribed one is the Lavipravir. This antivirals can actually reduce the number of virus. Actually, it is not going to cure or giving 100% cure for you. It is going to reduce the number of virus in the body so that the host inflammatory response is going to be less. But do not think that this, you take antivirals, you are going to be cured 100%. That is not the case. It is just going to reduce the viral load. So once the host enters into, that is the patient enters into the inflammatory response phase, that is the patient become started showing more of symptoms, then the other things, steroids, as I said before, and the newer treatments like plasma therapy and IL-6 inhibitor, that is tocilizumab. I'm not going into details of it. Few other treatment modalities apart from steroids, that is plasma therapy and IL-6 inhibitors, are being tried. There are few evidences, but we don't have any strong evidence that yes, this is going to cure you for definitely. There are few cases which have come out with these treatment very good, but there are few cases in spite of all these modalities do succumb. Still, we are not clear what is actually happening and what could be done to save all patients. With that, going to next question: how long a person will be infected? This is a gray area. Still, it is not very clear. For now, 14 to 28 days. That's why even the patient is asymptomatic, few governments and few institute policies are to quarantine the patients for at least 2 weeks. Few institutes still go ahead and quarantine the patients or the positive tested persons for at least 28 days. So 14, 28 days, what is going to be the treatment? Treatment, believe me, it is going to be supportive care just as for all viral illness. 80 to 90% of patients going to recover without any symptoms or without any sequelae with just supportive care. For other persons, say 10 to 20% of patients may require oxygen. This oxygen may be via simple face mask or through ventilator. I'm not going into details of it. As I said before, blood thinners. Why we give blood thinners? Because second hypothesis, which causes clotting of blood around the pulmonary vessels, which may not allow the oxygen exchange between the air sac, that is alveoli, and the blood vessels. For that, we are using the anticoagulants heparin and steroids to suppress the immune response so that our body doesn't get hit by the inflammatory response per se. And the antivirals, as I said before, to reduce the viral load. And this convalescent plasma therapy is like, suppose I get an infection, I do recover from the infection. What is the response of my body? I do develop some antibodies against the particular infection. Here, say the coronavirus. What does this antibodies do? Second time, if it enters the body, these antibodies fight against the organism and prevents the organism from multiplying and causing further insult to the body. So if I donate my blood, and the plasma is taken from the blood, this plasma can be given to your patient who is going for a hyperinflammatory response, where this plasma can fight against those organisms in the body, say the coronavirus here, and prevent further damage. This plasma therapy, again, it is under investigation. There are few institutes in North India prescribing it regularly. Even in Chennai, few hospitals started doing this. But still, there are no definite evidence or guidelines to follow this treatment. And there are few more investigational therapies being undertaken to tackle against this virus. So more of supportive treatment. The things actually going to help for now are oxygen, blood thinners, steroids, and antivirals. this plasma therapy and other nutritional therapies do may come up in your future. So this is, in short, I have spoken about the microbiology, this novel coronavirus, how does it spread and how long it survives on surface, what it actually does to us, what is the incubation period and what are the symptoms and how long a person will be infected and what is the treatment. This is in very short about the signs of COVID-19. If you do have any questions regarding the microbiology, you can ask me at the end of the session. Going to the second part, the most important part, which is going to be important for every person, everyone, not only a healthcare worker, for everyone, they should be aware of all these points. First is, why contact tracing important? Second, how to safeguard ourselves? That is the crux of this talk. How to use mask, how to use the sanitizer, and social distancing. The third one, hydroxychloroquine. The fourth one, who are at risk of getting severe disease? And what to do when we get symptoms? Regarding vaccines, regarding herd immunity, regarding alternative medications, and the important question, when this will end, when we will be back to normal, and who are responsible to fight against this war. Going to the first question, contact tracing. Many of our family relatives or friends do think that we should not disclose our family friends or friends whoever is tested positive. That is totally wrong. We should help the government. We should help the health authorities. You find a positive person infected, you do contact tracing. That is the number of persons who had come in contact with that person in recent time, so that you can identify that person and take him apart and isolate, so that that person is prevented from spreading the infection to the other person. So this is the importance of contact tracing. This one, every one of you know, just I'm stressing on this point. Make sure that if you do come across a positive patient, advise him on proper isolation and contact tracing. So right now, it is a community spread. So contact tracing is still important, but the actual question to be asked in the current situation is how to safeguard ourselves and others. Right now, in the current situation, as of today, we don't have a sword to fight against. We don't have anything to kill the virus. We have only shields. We can protect ourselves. So how to use it wisely? The important point is consider everyone as a positive case. You're going near your closest of the friends. Consider him as positive. Maintain distance from him. Use your mask. Use your sanitizer. Don't reduce the defense. Use this SMS. Every one of you have come across this famous mnemonic, which all we go through in the WhatsApp and all of the social media. Again, I'm stressing on it. Social distance. Never relax your defense. You're going with your friend to the coffee shop. Sit there together, nearby. So lower your mask, drink. Never do that. Never go to a coffee shop with your friend. Sit nearby and take. Be obsessed. Be of the thought that even your closest friend is positive and he is sick. Then you will maintain the social distancing automatically. By shielding yourself, you are protecting yourself and also your family, especially your old age parents, old age other persons in the home, by getting these, who are at more risk of getting severe disease. So always be cautious when you go near even your known closest of the friends. Going to the next one, what is the social distancing? As I said in the first part, when you cough or sneeze, the aerosols or droplets can spread up to 6 feet. That is the 2 meter. That is the idea behind this 2 meter social distancing. Try to maintain as much as possible. Try to maintain the distance as much as possible, at least of 2 meters. Actually, what the social distancing does, apart from helping us from contracting high viral load, it also helps to reduce the number of cases peaking in a particular short period of time. So say 100 cases come at this part, imagine 100 cases come over 10 days. Over 5 days, 100 cases, our health system may not be able to handle. Say the 100 cases come in over 10 days, our health system will be able to handle. So you're helping yourself, you're helping your family, and also the health system, which is working immensely to against this COVID virus. So these are the points regarding social distancing. Coming to the important part, mask. This is the only difference we have, only important difference. So nowadays, we have all seen about these masks. The first is the fabric mask. The second is the surgical three-ply mask. The fourth is the N95 mask. So this surgical three-ply mask, it is not just the three folds we see. You buy a mask, you cut a mask and see, there will be three layers. First layer, a non-woven material. Second over, meltdown filter paper like material. Third one is again a non-woven material. Be sure that you wear a 3-ply mask. I'm going to tell the details how to wear and what. The third one is the N95 mask. Obviously, it is going to give the maximum protection. Having said that, should everyone use N95 mask? Answer is no. Still, N95 gives the maximum protection. I'll tell you why. This is the CDC recommendation, that is Center of Disease Control recommendation. What it recommends is people can use cloth face, that is wear cloth face, that is fabric mask, in public settings and when around people who don't live in your household. When you meet a stranger, when you do not know who is that, a simple fabric mask is going to help when social distancing measures are difficult to maintain. So this is what CDC recommends. But if you are able to afford, that is at least fabric mask should be maintained, or at least 3-ply surgical mask. It costs around 8 to 10 rupees depending on the place where you live. A 3-ply surgical mask for healthcare workers, even for healthcare workers with minimal risk of exposure, say a security working in a hospital, his risk of exposure is going to be very minimal. He is not going to to handle the patient directly, so his risk of exposure is very minimal. For such workers, even 3-ply mask is good. N95 masks for people who care for positive cases. So you have an asymptomatic patient in your home without any symptoms and patient being home quarantined, you are going to care for that patient, then N95 mask is warranted. You are a health worker, say doctor working in close vicinity of the patient, again N95 mask is warranted. Or for those who handle the patients with high suspicion of corona. So at least a fabric mask or a 3-ply mask. N95 mask is the best. Still, wearing an N95 mask and carrying day-to-day activities is going to be very difficult and it causes suffocation. You will tend to bring down your N95 mask when you do a day-to-day activities, which is going to increase the chance of infection. So for any public, if they are affordable, 3-ply mask or at least fabric mask, I would recommend. So the important one, how to wear a non-medical fabric mask safely. These are the points. Before wearing the mask, clean your hands. Then inspect the mask whether it is contaminated. Adjust the mask to your face without leaving gap on sides. It should cover your mouth, nose. It should reach at least half of the bridge of the nose and your chin. In between, never try to touch the mask. If you want to adjust, you can adjust the straps. And clean your hand before removing the mask. You enter your home, just like that you don't remove the mask. You clean your hands with sanitizer or soap and then remove the mask by straps. Don't hold the mask in front or side or inwards and remove. Remove by the straps and pull the mask away from the face and store the mask in a plastic resealable bag. And remove the mask, and if you're going to use it again, you remove with holding the straps. And if it is a fabric mask, in between you can wash with soap or detergent and clean your hands after removing the mask. This step is important because this mask may contain some fomites, some aerosols deposited on it. You just handle it, you get contaminated your hand, and you're going to touch your nose or eyes or mouth, you're going to get infected. So handling the mask is also important. That is about what you should do. This is about what you should not do. Again, to stress the importance of handling the mask, do not use a mask if it looks damaged. Do not wear a loose mask. I wear a loose mask and I'm able to breathe comfortably. That is totally wrong. It should be tight, it should be actually causing a little bit of discomfort to you. And do not wear the mask under the nose. I have seen many people working in and around wearing the mask, just covering the mouth. This should not be the case. And you meet a friend, you're going to speak, never lower your mask. It should be covering from the nose to the chin. And do not use the mask that is very, which is causing you more amount of discomfort. That is a thick face cloth mask. There are few people who are wearing a towel in and around their face, which is going to cause more of discomfort. Do not wear such thick mask also. And do not wear a dirty or wet mask, and do not share a mask with others. This is about fabric mask. This is about 3-ply surgical mask. The three things which I want to stress in addition to the fabric mask are, when you take a surgical mask, find the top side where there will be a metal piece or a plastic one inserted into it, which helps to place it over your nasal bridge in a stiffer way so that it causes effective seal. And ensure that the colored side faces outwards. usually surgical mask will have two colors. One is the colored one and the lighter one. The colored one should face outside. So remember this, all other parts of the do's of the surgical mask is same as for the fabric mask and the don'ts also. So I'm not going to tell it about again. Do remember that wash your hands before touching the mask and wash your hands after discarding the mask to prevent yourself contaminated from the fomites deposited on your mask when you're wearing and going around. So common mistakes what we do. Don't wear your mask below your nose. Never wear your mask lower on your nose. Never leave your chin exposed and wear your mask. Don't wear your mask under your chin. Don't let your mask hang loosely. So it should cover the nose till the chin so that you are given maximal protection. So these are the common mistakes what we do see daily. So wearing a mask properly, actually it helps you and also others. It helps you preventing contaminated from the other person, and also when you cough or sneeze with your proper mask on your face, it also prevents spreading, if you are infected, to other persons. So it helps you and others and vice versa. So coming to the next, yes, how to use a sanitizer. Usually an alcohol based sanitizer is enough. At times, if you think that your hand is visibly soiled, you can use soap based sanitizers, which will give some foam and you can wash it clearly. So these are the steps. This picture and video are largely available in all sites. Just I want to stress there are few important steps which you can follow easily over just 20 seconds, which will give you adequate protection from the contamination. I'm not going into details. You can Google and you can search it, the proper techniques of hand washing. First, rub over the dorsal, then fingers interlock, then having rotation motion, palm within palm. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Sir, no, 5 minutes of session is going to end.
Okay.
Can we change the login, sir?
Yeah, sure, ma'am. Yeah, sure.
Participants, in chat box, one more login has been given because this is a 50 minutes, that is a WebEx meeting has been done for 50 minutes, but it has been as it is got extending. So can we log in into other link? So link has been done in chat box. Please, sorry for the inconvenience. So please log in to that link. I think everyone can view the link in the chat box. Kindly please, everyone, continue the meeting. The second link.